Well, welcome to the 700 Club. President Obama is facing his first major global security crisis. North Korea launched a missile on Sunday that traveled twice as far as any other Korean rocket.
Incredible. The UN Security Council met soon after the launch, but it doesn't look like they're actually taking any serious action. Here's reporter Paul Strand.
The president's focus this weekend was on nuclear weapons, especially with the world all abuzz over North Korea's Sunday missile launch.
Certainly, this launch does put them closer to being able to strike the United States. Certainly, it gives them more capability. They can stage rockets, and more generally, that they've got the basic concept correct.
Obama and his people called on the United Nations to act.
It is our view that this action merits a clear and strong response from the United Nations Security Council.
Violations must be punished. Words must mean something. The world must stand together to prevent the spread of these weapons. Now's the time for a strong international response.
But it's likely little will happen but talk. That's because China, North Korea's main protector in the Security Council, can veto any UN action.
It's calling for calm, it's calling for restraint, but ultimately, because it is the main provider of fuel and food to North Korea, it does have the key role to play in this. I think that China probably will not take any strong action.
But in the U.S., at least one Republican was saying he would have disabled the missile.
We do not appreciate the scale of threat that is evolving on the planet, and North Korea is a totally irresponsible dictatorship run by a person who is clearly out of touch with reality. And I think to say, you know, we're now going to have another meeting of the UN to have another paper resolution that has meaningless effect is very dangerous.
Gingrich went on to warn.
We have been talking about this since the Clinton administration, right, and they have been building nuclear weapons and building better and better missiles while we keep talking. And one morning, just like 9/11, there's going to be a disaster, and people are going to look around and say, gosh, why didn't anyone think of that?
The Korean launch upstaged Obama's highly publicized speech on nuclear disarmament.
If we believe that the spread of nuclear weapons is inevitable, then in some way we are admitting to ourselves that the use of nuclear weapons is inevitable. I'm not naive. This goal will not be reached quickly, perhaps not in my lifetime. We have to insist, yes, we can.
Obama suggested since the U.S. is the only nation to have ever actually used nuclear weapons, it's America's duty to lead the world towards nuclear disarmament. Paul Strand, CBN News, Washington.
Thanks, Paul. I agree with Newt Gingrich. It'll just be a lot of talk, and that's all that they're doing. But Kim Jong-il apparently has had a stroke from what we gather. He's losing control. The military is probably taking more and more power in North Korea. But their danger is not so much the fact that they might launch a missile, but that they'll sell this kind of technology to Iran and other rogue nations. And if the Iranians, who have nuclear weapons or are getting ready to get them, if they get a missile like that Taipodong 2, oh my, they've got all Europe under their power, and the threat of terror will be, it'll be unimaginable what can happen. But the genie, they say, is out of the bottle. And ladies and gentlemen, Chris, Newt Gingrich was saying we ought to have some besides talk, but what do you do? I mean, do you literally go in there and shut North Korea down? I imagine if there's any possibility that the people would flee that country, it's like a huge prison. The amount of calories that each citizen gets is so deficient that the North Koreans are much smaller in stature than the South Koreans because they're being starved. It's a horrible, horrible dictatorship. But so far, we've done nothing but talk. We probably won't do anything else but talk. There isn't the will in this country to take any kind of bold action. And I'm not sure any of us exactly look forward to a war in Korea. I was back there in 1950. I don't think anybody wants to go back over there again. Lee Webb has the rest of our top stories from the CBN newsroom. Lee?
Pat, a powerful earthquake has killed at least 70 people in Italy, and the death toll expected to rise. The quake struck near the city of L'Aquila, about 70 miles northeast of Rome early this morning, but it was felt in the capital city. The strong 6.3 magnitude quake caused entire blocks of buildings to fall as residents slept inside. A college dormitory also collapsed, trapping dozens of students under the rubble. Rescue crews are searching for an unknown number of missing people.
I've heard news about a man who is still searching. His wife seems to be covered by the ruins.
And we're told now that thousands are homeless, and part of L'Aquila's main hospital had to be evacuated because of fears it may collapse. General Motors is softening its opposition to declaring bankruptcy. The new GM chief executive tells CNN, quote, "If it's required, that's what we'll do." But Fritz Henderson says GM would rather avoid bankruptcy. President Obama said GM's initial restructuring plans didn't go far enough. Last week, he told the company it had 60 days to make more cuts and get more concessions from bondholders and unions, or it wouldn't get any more government aid. Pat?
Well, you're just not going to negotiate any of those cuts and concessions. The union chiefs can't make them. The bondholders won't make them. Nobody's going to make them. And so the only option, as I've been saying now for months and months and months and months, is Chapter 11 bankruptcy. But they need to get on with it. They need to get a plan. They need to set it out very clearly, and they need somebody in the government to say, all right, we'll pick up debtor in possession financing and get into bankruptcy and get through it as quick as you can and get back in business. And that's what will happen if they do it right. And, of course, when they do, it'll mean they have a competitive advantage over Ford, and they'll have a competitive advantage vis-a-vis Toyota. Lee?
The Treasury Secretary is putting bailed-out bank CEOs on notice. On CBS's Face the Nation, Timothy Geithner said if banks get government bailout money, they may have to shake up their boardrooms and put in new executives. Geithner says it's nothing new. It says it's already happened at mortgage giants Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac and insurance giant AIG.
We've done that because we want to make sure that taxpayers' assistance is going to make these companies stronger, make sure there's accountability, make sure it comes with strong conditions. And we'll do that in the future if that's necessary.
Geithner also says any more support banks get from the government will come with requirements to make sure the banks are using the money to increase lending to consumers and businesses, Pat.
Well, you know, the original TARP, it was just a joke. We thought it was going to help get loans out to consumers. Instead, the money went right through. It was a pass-through, for example, from AIG to other banks that just helped banks and helped speculators. And the boys in Wall Street took care of their own. But this whole idea of the government deciding who's going to be the head of a company and who isn't, that's outrageous. And to say, well, I'm going to force this one out, and that one out, and that's socialism, and it's not a good thing. Lee?
Pat, a record number of people are falling behind or in default on their loans, and economists tell USA Today that it's only going to get worse. The American Bankers Association ties it to rising unemployment. Those people without jobs are having a hard time paying their bills. About 663,000 jobs were cut in March and more than 2 million since January. One advisor says people are paying on their credit card and auto loans before making a mortgage payment. That's because many people owe more on their home than it's worth. Gay and lesbian couples will be allowed to get married in the state of Iowa. That's right, the heartland state of Iowa, beginning April 24th. In a landmark decision, the state Supreme Court struck down a ban on same-sex marriage, and those opposed to the decision have few options.
There really is no way to appeal this at a legal level. The only way this can be overturned is the way that Californians overturned the decision out there, and that is by a referendum that would amend their constitution to make it clear that marriage is limited to a man and a woman.
But a referendum won't be able to get on the ballot until 2012. Still, many wonder how this could happen in the heartland state of Iowa. One legal observer told me Friday that Iowa's state house is controlled by liberals who handpicked the Iowa Supreme Court. And Pat, it is those justices who issued this ruling.
Lee, the shocking thing, and it's happened, ladies and gentlemen, over the years, that we have been dominated by left-wing judges. Unelected judges who have issued fiat rulings which have totally changed the cultural landscape of this country. And we sit there idly by and we talk about all these wonderful things that are happening, but that's the bottom line. And the people are frustrated. They overwhelmingly vote to preserve marriage is between a man and a woman, but these five or six judges, three or four judges in these various states just make their rulings, and then it takes years, years to undo what three or four liberal judges do. You know, Thomas Jefferson warned us about being ruled by a tyranny of an oligarchy. He was right on the money, a very wise man, and his words come across the centuries to say, well, Thomas, you were right, a tyranny of an oligarchy. Lee?
If several U.S. senators have their way, American citizens will soon be able to travel freely to Cuba for the first time in almost 50 years. International correspondent Gary Lane has more.
Good afternoon to all of you.
North Dakota Senator Byron Dorgan and Senator Mike Enzi of Wyoming have introduced legislation called the Freedom to Travel to Cuba Act. They say it's time for America to treat all communist countries the same.
We say with China, we say with Vietnam and others, constructive engagement through trade and travel is the right way and the best way to move those countries towards greater human rights. That is significantly a part of what we suggest with respect to Cuba. This is about change and the road to freedom for the Cuban people.
The U.S. imposed travel and trade bans in 1962, just 3 years after Fidel Castro seized power in Cuba. Currently, only travel for journalists and humanitarian aid workers is allowed. Senators Dorgan and Enzi represent farm and ranch states. U.S. farmers and businessmen support the legislation. They hope it will lead to the lifting of other restrictions so they can enter the Cuban market. How did Cuba respond to the news? Cuban Vice Minister of Tourism, Maria Elena Lopez. She says, we are preparing for international tourism, and so if it comes, we will see. But the President of the United States has not spoken on the matter. And some Republicans like Mel Martinez of Florida, a state that is home to nearly 1 million Cubans, oppose the legislation. Senator Martinez says the United States should support pro-democracy activists, not the Castro regime. Gary Lane, CBN News.
Pat, what do you think? I mean, we've had this travel ban in place for a number of years, in fact, decades, and nothing really has changed in Cuba. Do you support Senator Dorgan on this?
Well, I haven't really studied the proposal enough to take a definite position on it, Lee, but I do think we've got to make some ties back and forth between us and Cuba. Fidel is sick. He's going out of the picture. His brother Raul is old, and he'll be passing off the scene. We ought to do everything we can to see a regime change. That's the only really major communist country that's still sticking to traditional Marxist-Leninist philosophy. You look at how China's opening up and other countries are opening up. Russia certainly changed, and it seems like to me they're isolated. And the fact that some tourists go down there isn't exactly going to keep communists in power. Christy?
I got you, Pat. Well, got a question for you. Have you been watching the Final Four at all? Keeping up with it?
Just momentarily, but I do know North Carolina is going to be playing.
And some people think that North Carolina are actually going to win.
You do think so?
Well, I don't know. That's what someone told me.
They keep winning. Well, they had a pretty good run the last game they played. It was, you know, they had it way ahead in the first half, and then they got it down about 9 points, and they pulled ahead. They've got quite a team.
Well, I tell you, it's going to be a good game tonight. Well, coming up later, we've got an all-access pass to the Final Four championship, and we're going to show you why these players actually have more than just basketball on their minds.
Every day is a blessing. You can't just feel blessed that you're in this position. You know, just you can't change anything. You know, just because you're at the Final Four. You know, every day is a blessing, and you know, we just feel fortunate to be here.
You got to stick around because we're going to take you inside the locker rooms of the best teams in college hoops. So stay with us.
My name is Phyllis Ellis, and I am a cancer survivor.
The surgeon said, you have cancer.
Even his touch was cold. It was like I didn't have life.
So I said, well, you know what? I'll be back. And I never came back. I called the Cancer Treatment Center of America. They took me by the hand. They explained things to me. They're compassionate. They feel my pain. They knew me better than I knew myself. The energy that I got from them, I took that and I gave it to the patients. I said, let me tell you something. We are fighters, and fighters win.
Call now and we'll send you this free DVD that shows you how the most compassionate group of people anywhere puts you at the center of everything we do. Advanced medical treatment combined with unique supportive therapies give you treatment options you may not even know exist.
Oh my God, I got my life back again. Just want to sing every day. I got a song in my heart.
I'm healthy. I'm good.
Please call today.
Tomorrow, a dream wedding ruined after a fiancé freaked out. How this bride-to-be survived the ultimate altercation. And on Friday, celebrate Easter by retracing the last steps of Christ.
From an archaeological perspective, from the Mount of Olives to his crucifixion, a new suggested itinerary is emerging.
This week on the 700 Club.
Well, it's an outreach to Islam. President Obama's in the Islamic nation of Turkey today. He wants to strengthen American relations with that country, and the rest of the Muslim world is watching the visit. They want to see how Obama plans on changing American foreign policy. George Thomas is in Istanbul with more on this presidential visit.
It began with a promise on inauguration day.
To the Muslim world, we seek a new way forward based on mutual interest and mutual respect.
Less than 100 days later, here on the streets of Istanbul, many are surprised that Mr. Obama chose Turkey as the country to keep his promise to reach out to the Muslim world within the first 3 months of his presidency.
I'm shocked that he's here, especially since most American presidents only visit Turkey much later in their term.
But then again, this is not your typical Muslim country. Yes, Turkey is overwhelmingly Muslim, but has over the years managed to delicately balance religious and secular values.
Turkey is an interesting country in that it has an 80-plus year history of separation of mosque and state. It has a secular set of laws and institutions. It is a member of the West in terms of being a NATO member and a candidate member of the European Union. And it's also 99% Muslim.
Turkey's geography is also unique to the region.
Turkey literally straddles two continents, Asia on one side, Europe on the other. We are often seen as a bridge between Europe and the Muslim world.
And this is precisely why analysts believe President Obama's visit here is so important. You see, in recent years, Turkey has cultivated ties with some of its neighbors that are today big foreign policy challenges for the United States.
If you look at the map, and you look at the countries surrounding it, you know, Russia, Iran, Iraq, Syria, these are all places where vital American interests are involved. They have been willing to sort of step into some of these breaches in an attempt to try to help some of the bigger countries like ourselves solve some of the problems that are so important to the Turks themselves.
Many Turks say they're only too happy to help Washington improve relations with the Muslim world.
Before, Turks were always hidden behind the Americans and doing whatever the American administration was telling them. But this time, Turkey's stocks are rising in the international community, that's for sure. And it is the Obama's visit is the real example for that.
Obama will also focus on Iraq and Afghanistan during his two-day visit. Turkey was against the Iraqi invasion and refused to allow American forces into Iraq through Turkey. Now, the president is hoping to convince the Turks to let him use the American base at Incirlik to help get those troops out of Iraq.
It's not a given, but I think it's something that certainly could be discussed and probably will be when the president's there.
On the Afghan front, Turkey has some 900 soldiers serving in that theater. Mr. Obama will press Turkish leaders, along with other NATO countries, to send more troops to Afghanistan. The White House is also hoping to use this visit to reboot America's image, especially in the Muslim world. A recent poll showed that 44% of Turks view the U.S. as the biggest threat to their country. Only 4% see America as Turkey's most important friend.
America's wars in Afghanistan and Iraq have done great damage to our country's image. People are very skeptical about their global intentions.
But that same poll found President Obama's approval rating much higher than his predecessor.
We are not under any illusions. It is going to take a lot of time to rebuild America's image in the Muslim world. No single person can do it in a short span of time. It is a very long process.
Not sure if the president will get a chance to do any souvenir shopping before he heads home on Tuesday. Mr. Obama has pledged to make a major speech in a Muslim capital. He will not be making that speech here in Turkey. Still, Turks and millions of Muslims around the world will be watching and listening very carefully to see if indeed this new American president can create a new way forward with Islam's 1 billion plus population. George Thomas, CBN News, Istanbul.
Yeah, I applaud this. You know, Turkey has been on the sort of on the borderline. They want to be European, and the Muslims are pulling them back the other way. But they were started as a secular democracy. Kemal Ataturk, you know, set up when he did his revolution, he made them into a secular country. It's a separation, as they said, of mosque and state. And they want to be friends with Europe, and I think this is a good move.
So what do you think about Obama extending himself to the country of Turkey?
To Turkey, good news. If he goes over and prostrates himself before the Iranians, it'll be a big mistake. But the Turks, I mean, they here's the Bosphorus, and here's Europe on one side, and here's all the Middle East on the other, and Turkey is right in the middle. They used to have that huge empire, the Ottoman Empire, and they controlled huge swaths of land up into Europe, and they fought with the Habsburg dynasty for the longest kind of time. So now it would be a smart thing to bring them into NATO, to bring them into the European Union, to have trade with them. It would be a very, very important thing.
That's a good thing. Do you think that Obama will be able to have favor to be able to go in there and get the troops out through Turkey? You think the favor's going to come?
Sure, why not?
Cool.
Yeah, okay.
Good to know.
All right.
Good to know.
Okay.
Well, we're going back to basketball.
Okay.
All right.
Some hoops.
Up next, some hoops. Get ready for some basketball players from the Final Four teams talk about how they handle the pressure.
Just knowing that I don't really need to worry, you know? Someone's always going to have my back through ups and downs. So being in a big-time situation like this, you can just really be free to play and just enjoy the whole situation.
You got to watch our behind-the-scenes coverage of the College Hoop Championships after this.
Hate psoriasis.
Love clearer skin.
Forget the embarrassment.
And the flaking.
Humira can help clear your moderate to severe plaque psoriasis. In one clinical trial for psoriasis patients, 7 out of 10 people taking Humira saw 75% skin clearance, and 6 out of 10 patients had clear or almost clear skin at 16 weeks.
Humira can lower your ability to fight infections. Some patients have had serious infections, including tuberculosis, and infections that spread throughout the body. Some of these serious infections have been fatal, so tell your doctor right away if you have ever had tuberculosis or hepatitis B, are prone to infection, or if you get an infection. Do not start Humira if you have an infection, such as an open cut or sore or the flu. Certain types of cancer, non-melanoma skin and lymphoma, and blood disorders, nervous system disorders, serious allergic reactions, and new or worsening heart failure have occurred. Hate covering up.
Love seeing a difference.
Talk to your dermatologist about your psoriasis treatment options. Ask whether Humira may be right for you. Go to Humira.com today.
Well, the Final Four is down to the Final Two. Now it'll be Michigan State and North Carolina tonight with college basketball immortality. It's kind of a strong word, isn't it? It's on the line. Well, at least, let's put it this way, fleeting fame. CBN sports reporter Will Dawson is on the scene, and he discovered that players from the team see basketball as more than just a game.
Detroit, Michigan, home of the 2009 NCAA Men's Final Four, where the stage is all set for tonight's championship matchup between tradition-rich North Carolina and hometown favorite Michigan State. But this weekend was all about the Final Four, Michigan State, North Carolina, as well as Villanova and UConn. I spoke with players from each team about their love of basketball and where it ranks on their lists of priorities.
I have most fun playing basketball, but you do realize that, you know, this isn't the biggest thing in the world. Even though it's on the biggest, maybe seem like the biggest stage, everybody's watching and that kind of thing. There's a lot of hype, but at the same time, you do realize that, you know, the Lord has given you these blessings, and you kind of just take an eternal perspective on it and realize this may not be the most important thing in your life.
Villanova's spot in the Final Four is due to a last-second shot against Pittsburgh in the Elite Eight, courtesy of Scotty Reynolds.
I think every day is a blessing. You can't just feel blessed that you're in this position. You know, just you can't change anything. You know, just because you're at the Final Four. You know, every day is a blessing, and you know, we just feel fortunate to be here.
His teammate Antonio Pena agrees.
It's a great blessing being here. You know, especially being here with the team I'm here with now. And God put us in this spot to do best. I mean, Christ put us here in this position to, you know, keep playing. It's an everyday process.
North Carolina junior Deion Thompson is playing in his second consecutive Final Four, and the pressure to win is no different from last year. So Deion is trusting God.
Just knowing that I don't really need to worry, you know? Someone's always going to have my back through ups and downs. So being in a big-time situation like this, you can just really be free to play and just enjoy the whole situation.
So are you playing for an audience of one?
Yeah, basically. That's only one person you got to play. It's only standards you got to play to right there. You always got to think he's going to have something bigger for you, but no matter what happens on the court, how bad I play, how good I play, the relationship with God is always going to be the same.
Michigan State's Travis Walton is a great defender and a fierce competitor. His coach admits he's not the best player on the Spartans, but he makes up for it in heart. And his heart belongs to God.
It means everything. I think I wouldn't be here. A lot of people wouldn't be here, not just only me, but you know, I think it shows when you're going through adversity, and that's why you continue to have faith and continue to believe that he's going to help you get through things and you're going to make it through.
Jesus Christ is everything. He does everything for me. He gives me strength. He gives me basically the courage to do everything that I do, and you got to give all the glory to him.
To get to know God is something great. You know, it's something that you wouldn't trade for the world, because at the end of the day, when you do leave this earth, your soul's going to live on. And so definitely for kids out there to build their relationship with God and try and really get into the Word of God, because that's the best book there is out there.
Who is Jesus Christ to you?
My Lord and Savior, my Redeemer, just my Father. He loves me most anybody more than anybody could ever think or imagine. And, you know, forgive my sins. And I just, you know, thank him every day, try to glorify him the best I know how.
Let me ask you something. What are you going to do when this life ends? You know, I was reading a book on longevity yesterday. They were saying 120, even 150 years. Well, that's all well and good, but so it's 120 years. Then what are you going to do? What are you going to do? What's going to happen? So you're a hotshot basketball player in college. Then you graduate from college. Do you go to the pros? Maybe one or two out of this whole bunch will go to the pros. And even that, what's your career? Another 4 or 5 years? And then what? You're in business, so you've made a bunch of money. Then what? So you didn't make any money. So then what? So you had great amorous desires on a particular girl or a particular guy, and so you get married, and then you have children, and they grow up, and then what? You know, life goes on, and our role in it is so short. Really, you don't spend very long. You know, the Bible says our days is like a hand breadth. You put a hand up against the sky, and it's not very long. 80 and 10, now we're getting longer. We're getting closer to 80, and then some people living 90 and 100. But even so you live to be 100. So big deal. So what do you do then? Well, some of those basketball players have got it right, but let me ask you, have you got it right? If Jesus Christ were to call you out of this world tonight, where would you spend eternity? That's the question everybody asks, because your spirit will go on. Your body will die, but your spirit won't die. And it's either going to go to be with the Lord forever, or it's going to be apart from him forever in a place called hell. That's the choice you have, and you've got to make it now. So I want to give you a hand in making that decision. If you would like to choose life, if you would like to choose eternal life with God, I want you to pray with me. I want you to give him your life. And I want you to do it now. You don't have to be afraid. Believe me, he loves you more than you love yourself. So bow your head with me right now, wherever you are, and pray these words. And don't be afraid, because he loves you. Pray this word. Do it. Jesus, that's right. Pray with me. Jesus, I'm a sinner, Lord. And if I died today, I don't know where I'd be. But Lord, I know that you died that I might live. And as we come close to Easter, we realize your sacrifice and that you rose from the dead and you live forevermore. And you live for me. So Jesus, right now, I turn away from selfishness and sin and the temporal things of this life, and I turn to you, and I say, Lord, come into my heart, live your life in me, and I will live for you, and I will serve you all the rest of my life. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for hearing my prayer and coming into my heart. Now, Father, for those who prayed just then, may the power of God touch them in Jesus' name from this moment on. Keep them, Lord. Amen and amen. If you've prayed with me, it's the most important prayer you'll ever pray. And I want you to do something. I want you to tell somebody. I want you to solidify that decision. I'd like to give you a little pamphlet, booklet, whatever, that'll help you. It's got a CD in it. It's got a book in it, and it'll tell you what to do next. The exchange life. You've been born again by the Spirit of God. I want you to listen to it, read it, and live it. Call right now, 1-800-759-0700, and just praise God for what He's done on this special Monday. Christy.
And Pat, well, I tell you, it's Monday. And what does Monday mean? It means it's Money Monday. And we want to answer many of your questions about finances. Brenda says, my husband does all the finances, and I'm kind of scared because if anything happens to him, I wouldn't have the slightest idea what to do. Is it too late for me to learn about finances? Well, Brenda, I'm going to tell you now the answer is no, but we're going to take a stab at helping you out with Bring It On. So don't go away.
We want to say thank you to the thousands of you who recently pledged to join the 700 Club.
You're changing the lives of millions of people around the world, like Rimbian, a little girl abandoned because she was born with a cleft palate.
I met Rimbian one early morning, crying, looking very dirty and looking hungry. Children were scared of her because of the cleft palate she had.
Rimbian was left to roam the streets alone. That's when you made it possible for her to receive surgery and live in a special school where she has food, friends, and love.
Your monthly gift allows us to pray for the sick, feed the hungry, and preach the gospel throughout the world and at home. So watch for this mailing and send in your pledge. You'll have the joy of knowing that every day, somewhere in the world, someone has been given hope and help because you were there.
New from Beverly Lewis, New York Times best-selling author, The Secret. When her mother's secret threatens to destroy their Amish family, Grace Byler wonders if some things are better left unknown. But will her search for the truth lead to more heartache or for the love she longs for? Discover the hidden world of the Amish in The Secret from Beverly Lewis, America's favorite author of Amish fiction. Get your copy today.
Welcome back to the 700 Club. The Final Four wraps up tonight in Detroit with North Carolina and Michigan State playing for the college basketball championship. While fans focus on the game, a couple of ministries are focused on getting the Word of God to the players. Nations of Coaches and Faith Comes by Hearing ministries are handing out audio Bibles to coaches and players. Last year, nearly two dozen college football teams listened to audio New Testaments. Sports chaplains say it's a perfect fit for the busy schedules of these student athletes. Thursday marks the last day the public can comment on the possible change to the Conscience Clause. That's the federal regulation which allows health care providers not to perform abortions if they object on moral grounds. President Bush supported that regulation, but President Obama has talked about removing it. If you'd like to find out more about how to comment on this issue and other stories from CBN News, just go to our website at cbn.com. Pat and Christy will be back with more of the 700 Club in a moment.
Heart attack!
Taking medication for bad cholesterol may not be enough. Focusing on bad cholesterol and not good cholesterol and triglycerides may raise your risk for a heart attack.
Any medications?
Yes, for high cholesterol.
Don't wait until it's too late to learn about the other two parts of your cholesterol. Like good cholesterol, is yours high enough? And triglycerides, too high, and they could be harmful. See if you're at risk with a free risk assessment. Call 1-888-877-9619 or visit forheartrisk.com. It gives you important questions to ask yourself and discuss with your doctor. Because if you're not managing all of your cholesterol, along with diet, exercise, and other risk factors, you may be at increased risk for a heart attack. So bring this assessment to your doctor and learn what your cholesterol numbers are. Don't wait to get your free risk assessment, because it's your life.
The best investment of the new millennium, gold.
Waves of change can destroy financial castles built on sand. But true wealth is built on a solid foundation of gold. Today's economic crises have caused many to look to government for financial solutions, but experts warn that borrowing trillions will result in higher inflation and less money in your pocket. Gold offers protection, liquidity, and growth. Rebuild your financial peace of mind, starting with a golden foundation.
Swiss America has provided millions of Americans with the best educational resources in print, online, and now on television. Take a moment to request a free Rare Opportunity booklet, CD, and DVD. Call the number below or visit online. Till next time, this is Pat Boone for Swiss America saying, don't wait to buy gold and wait.
Welcome back to the 700 Club. It's Money Monday today. Try to say that a lot. That's kind of difficult to do. So we're going to answer your questions about finances. Brenda writes in and she says, Pat, I've been married for 32 years. My husband takes care of me and does all the finances. I'm scared because if anything happened to him, I wouldn't have the slightest idea what to do. Do you think someone with no aptitude for numbers can actually learn about finances later on in life? And do you think it's worth the trouble?
Well, Brenda, if you got through the third grade, you have aptitude for numbers.
Amen.
You know, 2 and 2 equals 8. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, you know, 2 plus 1 is 3. That kind of stuff. That's really how complicated some of this personal finance is. But you really need to get a handle on where all the lock boxes are, what the various papers your husband has, what's been filed and what hasn't been, and you an inventory of the assets, because if he drops dead of a stroke, you're in a heap of trouble. And there are many wives that way, and it's just tragic to see them, and then some shark will come along and take their money away from them. So it's very important you understand it. And the other thing is very important is don't sign a tax return unless you understand what you are signing, because if your husband happens to be involved in fraud, you can go to jail just as quickly as him because you've signed off on it. So be very careful. Understand what you put your name on. All right? That warned you enough, huh?
Well, you did. I was really good. And you start talking about going to jail and sign stuff. I was like, oh, Lord.
Well, if a husband, if you sign a joint return, they look
That's
at
true.
It and say, okay, there's your name. You're part of the fraud.
That's true. You know what's going on in every situation. Yeah. Woo! Debbie writes in and says, I spoke with a friend about bankruptcy and I told her it wasn't the right thing to do. However, she said there was a day of jubilee, quote unquote, in Bible times where people's debts were forgiven. Is this true?
Debbie, it's absolutely true. The 50th year, all the debts were canceled. Slaves were set free. They put land back to its original owner. I mean, it was to keep one person from accumulating everything. You know, if you allow money to compound over the years, the person who's in charge of the compounding will own it all. I mean, literally. And so God knew that, and he said, okay, you can have your run 50 years. It's like a Monopoly game, and when it's all over, you redistribute the chips and you let another group of people come play. So Bankruptcy is there as an opportunity to alleviate the debts, the crushing debts on people.
And, do you ever think that's a wise decision, though, to file? Is there any time?
I'm sure there's a good time.
If,
for example, a corporation with all kinds of dissident shareholders and people clamoring for money and there isn't enough money, I mean, it's, you put the corporation, I'm suggesting putting General Motors in bankruptcy. Mm-hmm. There are various kinds. There's a Chapter 11, which is a restructuring, the Chapter 7, which liquidates the thing. But rather than have your telephone ringing at all hours of the night, it's better to put it into bankruptcy and say, well, I'm sorry, it's in bankruptcy and you can get your piece of the pie, whatever. It's not, I mean, there are a lot of people who use bankruptcy for fraud, and that isn't too good a thing, but it's there to help suffering, struggling people who can't get out from under a mountain of debt.
Good to know. All right, Keith writes in, and Keith says, I heard that legislation is currently being proposed to cap all credit card interest rates at 15%. This seems like a reasonable and welcomed move to me. Do you think we need an interest rate cap?
Yes.
I think it's Bernie Sanders of Vermont. He lists himself as a socialist, but he comes through fairly reasonably, and this isn't a bad solution. Mm-hmm. I think some of these credit card companies have absolutely been perpetrating frauds on people. And
they're sharks.
They are. And to set a cap is not the worst thing. Well, I hate government to get involved in all these business transactions, but nevertheless, that's not a bad deal.
Yeah, I totally agree with it just because, right. I mean, a lot of times you can get a credit card and, you know, you have it for 3 months and without you knowing, they switch it from 7%, next thing it's at 24%, and they don't, you know, it's in the fine line, things of those things.
They consolidate all the bills that you owe and they say, well, oops, you missed a payment on a bank thing 5 years ago, and therefore your credit score, you know, goes down and your interest rate goes up. It's not pleasant.
Yeah. All right. Okay, Candace writes in, and Candace says, Pat, when friends are in need of financial help, I'm usually good about helping them when I'm able. I have a hard time saying no. Some people seem to never learn how to manage their finances. What do you think is the best way to decide when to give and when to say no more?
Well, Candace, just look at who they are. If they're a bunch of freeloaders, I mean, tough love says you've got to make it on your own or else you starve. You know, the Bible says, if any man won't work, let him not eat. I mean, that's biblical. Mm-hmm. And this soft, touchy-feely stuff is just not smart. You don't help anybody by letting him be a continual beggar and come to you all the time. Help him. You know, instead of giving him a fish, teach him how to fish. That's the old statement. Teach him how to run his finances. And if he won't take his advice or else get him to a financial planner, if he won't take that advice, you know, tough luck. But don't just keep writing checks and giving it to freeloaders. That's not smart. That's not a Christian thing to do.
You know, that's such a good point, Pat, because I was talking to someone about this very thing the other day, and we were saying how it's easy to feel guilty because that's what Christians should do. You're supposed to give. But if you pray over everything and that spirit of discernment says, don't give that joke or anything, you know what I mean?
Well, how do you help some freeloader if you just keep him freeloading?
Exactly.
You know? All right.
Well, I'm with you. Okay, Angel writes in and says, is my tax refund check from the IRS considered income? And do you think we should tithe on this money? Ooh, that's a good question. What do you think?
Well, Angel, it depends on how you pay your tithes and on whatever. I mean, if you consider your gross income before taxes, then of course, whatever comes into tax. If you consider your net after tax income is what you tithe on, then if you get a refund, then that's something you want to pay a tithe on. But it's a nice thing. It's an extra money, and it gives you an opportunity to do something nice with money you weren't counting on anyhow.
I thought you were supposed to tithe on your gross because the Bible says give up your first fruit. So your first fruit is before everything's taken out.
I'm not interested in what you're supposed to do. I'm interested in what that woman is doing.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was
it's what
wondering
she's
that.
Doing.
All right.
Gross, net, whatever. I was in a meeting with the Secretary of the Treasury talking about that very thing, and he said that Ronald Reagan thought we should tithe, from the gross. And so they allow that on your, they let you give a lot of money away tax-free. All right.
Good to know.
Yeah.
Are they wrapping me up, or do I have time for one more?
No, you get one more.
Okay, cool. Mary writes in and says, Pat, I'm about $25,000 in debt. My income is about $1,500 per month, but my mortgage alone is $500 per month. What would you suggest for paying off such a large debt when there seems so little money left over at the end of the month?
Start, first of all, get your accounts in balance. Take the credit card or the debt that's the smallest one and knock it off. The old wisdom used to be pay off the highest interest rate first, but that goes against psychology. If you get the feeling like, I had a $1,000 debt and it's gone, that gives you a real good feeling. So let's get the next one at $2,000. So you start chipping away. $25,000 isn't all that much money. And it is amazing how fast you can knock it down. It means you cut back certain discretionary spending and you start paying it off. And it'll give you the greatest sense of satisfaction you can imagine. So do it. You can do it. It may take 3 years, but you can do it. Well, today, 5-year-old Ridwan loves to go to school and play with his friends. But not long ago, he didn't even like to leave his house because he was born with an unusual brain defect.
By the time 5-year-old Ridwan went to school, he'd become a very shy and withdrawn little boy. That's because he'd been born with 12 fingers and toes instead of the usual 10.
His classmates always gathered around him to look at his fingers. He tried so hard to hide them. He asked me, "Can I have your hand, Mommy? I don't want this one."
One day, Ridwan told his mom that he never wanted to go back to school again.
It was hard for me. I knew Ridwan was ashamed, but we knew he needed to get an education.
One day, a neighbor came over to tell Asi about an Operation Blessing medical clinic coming to their town in Indonesia.
The doctor told me that Operation Blessing would give Ridwan the free operation.
Operation Blessing set up the surgery for the boy, where doctors were able to remove the extra digits from his hands and feet. Within a few days, Ridwan was home playing with a new confidence, no longer afraid that people would stare at his hands. And Ridwan is not afraid to go back to school either, where he now enjoys playing finger counting games with all of his classmates.
I admire Operation Blessing because they took very good care of my son. Thank you very much. You have done a great thing for us. Ridwan can have a future because of you.
He can have a future. All over the world, people are being given a future because of you, because of your membership, because of your gifts. And what does it take to be a 700 Club member? 65 cents a day. It's pocket change. $20 a month. And we can help people like Ridwan. So go to your phones, if you would, 1-800-759-0700, and say, "You can count on me." And in the meantime, I want to send you wisdom for changing times. We've gotten very good comments from this, and I believe it's helped people. It gives you some clues about investing, about what's happening in the economy, and it'll help you. So go to your phones, call in, please, 1-800-759-0700, and say, "I want to help little children like Ridwan." Christy?
And Pat, we want to encourage people too. You know, it's not only raining here in Virginia Beach, but it's been raining a lot in North Dakota, and they've been dealing with a lot of flooding. So Operation Blessing, we're asking for volunteers. In fact, excuse me, they're on the scene right now and in North Dakota, in the town of Linton, where there's more than 70 different homes, and they need you. They need volunteers of more than groups of two or more to help just with the cleanups, whether it's helping residents move wet sheetrocks from their homes, serving hot meals for flood victims. This is what Operation Blessing is going to do. They're going to provide lodging, food, work, but we also need you to have transportation as well. So if you feel like the Lord's placed it on your heart to help, and we need you, we're asking you to be there on the scene. There's a number right there. It's 757-226-3407. You can always log on to CBN.com, but we need your help right now. And the folks in North Carolina, they desperately need you as well. So pray about that, because that, I promise you, will be a wonderful blessing. Well, still ahead on Money Monday. Are you in denial about your debt? Well, we're here to help you. We're going to show you a woman who actually paid off more than $100,000 of debt in just 3 years. That's still ahead.
However, there is another downturn in the economy.
It's been quite a ride. Economic turmoil, huge bailouts, stock market crashes, and continuing war in the Middle East. How can you prepare for what's next? In Pat Robertson's latest teaching, Wisdom for Changing Times, you'll get important biblical insight into vital issues of faith, finances, and your future. Get Wisdom for Changing Times. Available now.
We're downtown today campaigning to save America's teeth, because good dental health is about more than just brushing.
If you're one of the millions of Americans without dental insurance, call Encore Dental for affordable, quality dental coverage.
When was the last time you went to the dentist?
Like probably 3 years ago?
Probably back in college.
Poor oral health can lead to serious illnesses like heart disease and stroke.
What's your excuse?
It's just too expensive.
I'm self-employed.
No dental insurance?
None.
With Encore Dental, you can receive up to 100% coverage for preventative care and up to 50% on basic and major procedures.
George retired a year ago.
You know, when I did, I lost my dental coverage.
There are no claim forms and no waiting for reimbursement. Call now for a 30-day money-back trial period.
Call 1-800-757-4903 now for a 30-day money-back trial period.
Call now and get an additional 10% off when you pay by credit card.
Tomorrow, a dream wedding ruined after a fiancé freaked out. How this bride-to-be survived the ultimate altercation. And on Friday, celebrate Easter by retracing the last steps of Christ.
From an archaeological perspective, from the Mount of Olives to his crucifixion, a new suggested itinerary is emerging.
This week on the 700 Club.
The amount of debt that Americans carry around is crushing people who are already struggling just to get by. For them, financial freedom actually seems out of reach. But there is a way out of debt, and it's easier than you think. Take a look.
Lynette Calfani Cox teaches people how to be financially fit and is called the Money Coach. This wasn't always the case. In fact, Lynette was $140,000 in debt, but she was able to pay it off in 3 years without missing a payment. She used practical financial strategies, and she wants to share how you can get out of debt, too.
Please welcome to the 700 Club, the Money Coach, Lynette Calfani Cox. Good. Thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
I was stumbling because I wanted to make sure I got Calfani right. Your name.
It's a tricky one, I know.
It is a tricky one. Let's just jump right in because everyone, I don't care if you're rich, poor, have a job, don't have a job, we're all concerned about our money and what to do with it. So before we actually talk about how you got out of $140,000 of debt. Well, let's talk about it. Forget about it. Let's talk about that now.
Right.
First of all, what got you into debt like that?
Overspending. I was $100,000 in credit card debt alone. Mm. That was back in 2001. Fortunately, I was able to pay that debt off in just 3 years, and I never missed a single payment. Then I ended up writing a book about it, Zero Debt, The Ultimate Guide to Financial Freedom, and it just became a runaway bestseller, New York Times, Business Week, et cetera. And I share with others the strategies that I use personally, and now the folks that I've coached over the years, thousands of people who've used the same techniques and strategies to get out of debt. It can be done. And we know the Lord does not want us to be a slave to debt.
Exactly. So before we take on some of those steps of how to get out of debt, most people right now are asking, what do I do with my money? Do I take it? Do I pay off my mortgage? Do I double up on my credit cards? Or do I just put it in a savings account? What do people do?
Right. I think attacking the debt first and foremost should be a priority for most people. Some folks are paying 18, 25, even 30% interest on their credit cards alone, and that's money that could be put to use elsewhere. So definitely attack that first before you think about paying off the mortgage, which is probably a lower interest rate that you're paying on that, or doing other things like investing in the stock market.
Hmm. Now, you said that in your book, you talk about the dreaded D's. What are some of those dreaded D's?
Right. Well, the dreaded D's refer to the situations that people get into that lead them into debt, and it's downsizing, divorce, a death in the family of the main breadwinner, disability or disease. If any one of these five things happens to you, it can definitely throw your finances out of whack. And for a lot of people, it forces them to live on plastic. We also know, of course, that some of us get into debt, myself included when I was in debt, because of our own fiscal mismanagement, overspending or being a poor money manager. That's why now I've launched the Zero Debt Tour to teach folks all around the country, particularly in churches, about how they can stop that cycle of overspending and how they can get out of debt and learn to better save and better budget.
Okay, let's talk about the how. Everyone wants to know, how do you go from, not just you, $100,000, $20,000, $5,000 in debt to wiping it out when you might not have any money? Give me the concrete steps.
Okay, first of all, you've got to have a plan. So many people haven't even written down exactly how much debt they owe. Stop guesstimating, write down your bills and list everything in black and white. No more guesswork here. Secondly, you should know, okay, if I'm going to pay off the debt, what's the best strategy to do it? Pat was talking earlier to a writer or someone who wrote in and said, how should I pay off this credit card debt? He did a very smart thing to say, go after the lowest dollar balances first, as opposed to the higher interest rate debt, because that'll give you more satisfaction psychologically when you knock out one debt, then you can roll it over and go to the next debt that you have to knock out. You should also think about negotiating with your creditors. A lot of folks don't know you can call up your credit card company and ask for a lower interest rate. It's April, and so people are going to be getting tax refund checks. Use every windfall that you get, whether it's a government stimulus check or an income tax refund check. Use that money. Don't squander it like a lot of people are apt to do, but use that to pay off the debts as well. You might get a bonus from your job. You might get year-end money, holiday gift money. Don't waste that. And then, of course, start to go beyond making minimum payments. Too many folks fall into that trap, and it really is a trap, because I say that minimum payments now in the short run really mean maximum payments in the long run. So start to double and triple up on those payments that you're making to the credit card companies, and you'll find you'll wipe out those debts so much faster.
Now, can you call the credit card company and suggest that if your finance, your interest rate is at 15%, can you call and say, hey, listen, can we negotiate it down and take it down to 6%?
You can.
Yeah.
And again, most people are scared to do this, but one study found that 75% of those who called their credit card company and asked for a lower interest rate actually got it right on the spot. Mm-hmm. So sometimes that's yours for the asking. The key is, first of all, you have to look at your track record. If you've been paying on time, obviously you're a better candidate and you're in a stronger position to ask. But even those who've been late, maybe once the last 12 months or so because of the economic crisis, you can still call up your creditor and ask. The worst that can happen is they say no and you're in the exact same position that you've already been in. So I encourage people that they should ask and negotiate. And think about it also from the bank's perspective. Credit card issuers send out about 5 billion, with a B, credit card offers and solicitations every year to consumers. So that means there's a lot of competition. They don't want to lose your business. That's one reason that they might be willing to be more flexible.
What do you think about consolidating, putting all of them into one big chunk?
I think it can be a strategy for people, but I suggest that people try to negotiate first with their creditors. If that doesn't work, they should go to a trusted agency, a nonprofit agency. I like the National Foundation for Debt Management, for example. NFDM.org is their website. They'll negotiate on your behalf for you and get those interest rates lowered and help you create a plan to knock out the debt. They're partnering with me, as a matter of fact, for the Zero Debt Tour to go teach folks all around the country about financial literacy and getting out of debt.
We're running out of time as usual. So if there's one thing that you could tell our viewers, one key thing that they need to know to get their finances and their house in order, what would you say?
I would say to be realistic about your situation. Stop the cycle of overspending. Don't fall into the trap that too many of us have gotten caught up in trying to keep up with the Joneses. I call it living the bling bling lifestyle. And I'd also remind your viewers that God really doesn't want us to be in debt. Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. And I believe that means in your financial life as well.
You rock. Thank you so much for being here. I appreciate you, Lynette. Her book is called Zero Debt, The Ultimate Guide to Financial Freedom. It's available nationwide. If you want more information, we've got a free fact sheet for you. Pat, I'm going to throw it over to you as we wrap it up quickly.
Good information. Well, ladies and gentlemen, that's all the time we've got. So we'll leave you with these words from the Psalm. The Lord is faithful to all his promises and loving toward all he has made. See you tomorrow.
Tomorrow, a dream wedding ruined after a fiancé freaked out. How this bride-to-be survived the ultimate altercation. And on Friday, celebrate Easter by retracing the last steps of Christ.
From an archaeological perspective, from the Mount of Olives to his crucifixion, a new suggested itinerary is emerging.
This week on the 700 Club.
Hi, I'm Terry Musin. I'd like to tell you about Orphans Promise. Orphans Promise helps children who've had tragic beginnings in life.
My father died, my mother started drinking, and gave me away to the orphanage.
We were homeless, and she made me beg for food.
We don't know where our sister is. I'm looking for her now.
We want to return to be with our mother, but she doesn't want us.
In many countries, children are turned out of orphanages when they turn 16. They lose the only security they've ever known. Many will become easy prey for prostitution rings and criminal gangs. Together, you and I can break this cycle for these kids. For just $20 a month, you'll provide computer training, life skills, and people that care, preparing them for a future of hope. Show them God's love. Call the number on your screen right now and say you'll help.